Making life worth living in retirement with having is about the people in our lives. It's practically about the everyday work that we perform in every day. And it seems a little bit like a duplicated statement because I'm saying, in essence, the same thing every single time I start an audiocast. When I'm talking, I'm really talking about the people in our lives. If we lose a life partner who's the provider of our money for our household, we're sort of in dire straits because we might not have kept our professional alliances abreast as we were participating in being either a stay-at-home parent or a go-out-of-the-house parent. Even when we put ourselves into a position of employment, we have to really keep going with our professional connections. This morning, I literally walked past someone that I've met only once in life. I have a visual memory, so I recognize people fairly quickly. I don't always recall their name. That's sort of a deficit of mine. I probably inherited it a little bit from one of my parents who also struggled with that. And then I had another parent who was superior with that. I have a person that I really care for who is outstanding in that, at least from what I recall about her. But I'm making the point that in life, I recognize this person. She was kind enough to open the door for me this morning and allow me to walk through with my travel baggage. Some of it is mine, others of it belongs to other people, but in reality, it's not my place to share with you what is what. What I'm saying is that literally, I nailed her to a T of what she does. I said, "You're a nutritionist, aren't you?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, "You're a chef, aren't you?" And she said, "Yes." And then she simply walked back in and shut the door. What I found so fascinating is here I'm nailing her for what she is and who she is and what she does, but she didn't have the professional courtesy at that moment in time, possibly because she had a grandchild inside, to actually talk to me and say, "Now, how is it that you know that? Where have we met before? How are you doing?" Or anything of social professional networking discourse. Now, if she has made all her billions of dollars and is really ready profoundly, professionally for retirement, or if she has a man who's handled that all for her, wonderful. But in life, we only have moments of time to put ourselves on a course of career. And if our course of career is repetitive, we might only stay in a position a couple years and then bungle around and go find another company to do the same thing over again, looking for new relationships and new opportunities. The reality is sometimes we have to change directions entirely. Sometimes we have to stop, drop, and roll, if you will, in a fire situation. But what I mean is that practically our relationships either light us up like a Christmas tree, or they burn us down like old wood and dead wood that can be used in a fire pit. That sort of happened to me as I was in manufacturing and as corporate communication and interpreter. I was learning how to interpret across multiple disciplines that I had never had any experience with at all when I lived abroad, but I still had to learn how to do some of it or teach the people how to talk through the language barrier. And I think that was my greatest gift to that organization, was teaching them how to love each other and enjoy each other despite the language deficit. To say, "Hey, look, everybody's got to eat, everybody's got to sleep, everybody's got to poop, everybody's got to do all this sort of stuff, but we've got to work together and we've got to figure it out, and I can't be everywhere there is, and I don't know every language word there is, but if you work it out, if you puzzle it out, if you pictogram it out, you'll figure it out." And basically, that's what they did. They also had English trainers, too, and that allowed the Japanese to look things over. I guess what I'm talking about is the establishment of relationships, that relationships are begun, lost, and won again by people who are of the faith. And of the cloth is not really what I mean. Of the faith means that they truly walk their life like Jesus. Now, I only say that because we live in a Judeo-Christian nation. We have a lot of other different faiths here that I would never disparage. I would never in a million years insult anyone in any of the categories that are listed in my upcoming book on pendulum utilities in Christian faith. Now, I use it that way because I believe in a holy God. I also believe there's a satanic force that tries to destroy our lives and is helped along by people. You see, magic is what the Lord provides us. These are considered old ways. My spiritual guides, if you will, talk all the time about how there are old ways that the people of the world have forgotten. They wear their brands on them. Our clothes have brand names that are plastered on them, and we promote them when we buy those brands. Our colleges and alma maters have brands on them, and we promote those things on the outside of our house, at a chair at the front door, a front stoop, and we also put it on the front of our automobiles. We put that in our license plates. We choose who we're going to lay our alliance to, and I absolutely want to hurl when I see one of the alliance associations on a license plate, and it's not the pet lovers one at all. It's the dogs and stormtroopers of the world that I don't believe we need to have an alliance to, because I have not had a personal experience that celebrates and uplifts what they do in this world. But that's my own opinion. Now, when I say this, I'm being honest and true to my opinion. You have a different opinion. That's why your plate is different than mine. My license plate has a name on it, actually. It's a little plan. It basically is saying, if I die, this car belongs to you, love, and that's what it says. But the only person who knows that who that is supposed to be that individual who I call that name, that I've only called that name privately. But I do have people who have decided to study me, to violate my rights, and literally try and call me that name as a joke. I find it offensive. I'm not a love to anyone who's a total stranger. It's not an appropriate term. Hun and honey and all these other things that are from the South might be great down there, but practically we even live in a land of regard and respect. Endearment is great, but are you really going to continue that relationship with that stranger? It's more appropriate to learn their name, learn what they do, find out how you can help one another in life, and literally carry out your business entity, enterprise's responsibility with the utmost professionalism. Now, when I say this, I'm talking about real life. When I'm talking about real life, people may tune out just because they think it's so simple, but not exactly. I really practically want you to look at your life, and do you have the total rights and control and power in your life? Or is someone else deciding to mock your rights to your life, your body, your name, and the service that you've provided in the past in your soul? You see, when we perform our duties, we're not doing it buck naked. We're not literally saying, hi, my name is so-and-so, and I have this sort of body part, so you're going to treat me this way. We don't. We present ourselves. We present ourselves in the way that we feel comfortable. We present ourselves in a way that allows us to voyeur in on perhaps situations. And as a reporter, we sometimes disguise ourselves to find out what's going on in a particular organization. As a secret shopper, they walk in secret, don't they? We walk into a store as a secret shopper and literally just interact with the staff. We test the boundaries. We see how they treat people. We see how they treat people of all different shapes and sizes to see whether or not they're performing their duties to their utmost capability. But that's what people do in customer service. They have to decide, do they serve everyone or just some people? They have to decide, do they have tolerance for some things or just a few things? And openly, that is a store's policy by sure, but there's also a private aspect to an individual's life. You see, it's the private aspect to an individual's life that is purchasing the products, programs, and other aspects of property receipt that is going on in our public retail stores. Anytime a person purchases a book, they're saying, I'm using my discretionary dollars from my private life to purchase this book that might support my professional or personal ideologies or interests. And that's the absolute truth. Now, when I say this, this applies to everything in life that we buy, from our food to our homes to our clothes to our life possessions. We've made a decision about what's right for us. The same goes for our physical health care. We evaluate physicians. We decide whether or not we like them. We decide whether or not we trust them, and we also decide whether or not they'll help us with the conditions that we're concerned with. If they won't, we move on. We move to other physicians, and we keep looking until we find the right fit. That is our entitlement in America. It is also our privilege underneath the International Human Rights Declaration. Now, when I say this, it doesn't mean that I'm not thinking about your life. I'm totally thinking about your life. But what I'm thinking is you're probably taking all of that for granted. Because in your life right now, everything is flowing smoothly, beautifully, exceptionally well. But in a few weeks' time, in a few months' time, what if you have a hiccup? What if you get a challenge? What if you have a little personal crisis? Who do you turn to in those moments of time? Well, some people turn to parents who might still be alive. Other people turn to their family members, if they have any, and there's good relationships there. A third group of people you might turn to could be your neighbors or your church friends or whatever organizations in which you belong to or volunteer at. But if all those conditions are no longer a part of your life because of something that catastrophic that's happened to you, how do you get help today? Who do you go to? And what do they say when you get there? I'm going to be sharing about that part of life with folks in a few days, because in life, we can't listen to me every single minute of the day, but I do try and put enough content out there so that when your soul says, hey, listen to that one, you actually do. Isn't that it? We get promptings of what we're supposed to do in life. Sometimes we're prompted to stay away from someone. Other times we're prompted to leave a little food in a bag for someone because we're concerned about not only how we behave with them once before, but we're concerned in life about how they might feel in life. This has been Blake Ensign of Blaze Communications, LLC, saying thanks for listening.